Okay, good evening, guys. Today, team announcement, Springbok team announcement for the clash against Australia in Brisbane. We've got Springbok coach Rassie Erasmus and Damian Dalinda on the top table today. So please raise your hands for questions. Morgan?
Thanks, Z. Hi, Rassie. Hi, Damian. Rossi, to start off with, the most notable change is Sasha starting at flower for you guys. He's already proven to be one of the finds of the season in the national colours. So obviously, as a coach, you must be excited to give him this big responsibility in what is quite a big test this weekend.
Yeah, definitely. Good morning or evening for the guys on this side and the ladies as well. Yeah, no, it is a big opportunity for him, but, you know, like it is for Elrich and you know, Grant playing off the bench and a few others. We also have a bit of injury concern. I might just want to address that on Erg here and Rohan is standing in. But after the World Cup, you know, you're going to find some guys knocking on the door. But to have a guy like Andre with more than 70 caps on the bench, you know, that's nice security. And obviously, you know, with Damien Willems is still out, although Jordan Hedricks, we've given a chance, and Marnie here, we've got some nice depth there at 10. But yeah, exciting opportunity for him, and hopefully the forwards can give him the platform. And he's got a smooth game, which will be tough.
Greg?
Hi, thanks, Ina. Hi, Rassie. Sorry, my camera's not working. I seem to be on an older version of Teams. Just on the Sasha selection, would we be reading too much into it to say that this is a change in sort of the guard and this is the look to 2027 by selecting such a young raw player in a big rugby championship away test? Is this a sign of the future?
Well, definitely. As we all say internally, yeah, we can't look too far ahead and we'll forget the present. But we also can't just look at the present. And I think in the squad overall, you can see that I think there's about 9 guys in the squad. I counted today. That's probably wasn't regulars prior to the World Cup last year, which we're rotating in and out. And I wouldn't say it's a change of the guard. It's giving guys opportunity whilst guys like Andre and Marnie and those guys and Jordan have got opportunity whilst those guys are help nurturing these guys from test match level to test match level to, you know, it's his fifth cap. We used to, when we went to 2019 World Cup, we used to say we don't want to go with a guy under 8 caps, 9 caps to the World Cup. Yeah. And I think it's been well documented. I don't think there's been a World Cup won with a fly off of less than 24 years old. You know, I think Johnny Wilkinson was the youngest. So rather let a guy now, get him some proper backup, some nice experience with guys like Damien on his outside. And but then it's the same for Elrich, who plays at 8, who's playing his fifth cap. So it's not a change of the guard. It's a squad of 45 guys trying to win its test match and certainly with a hat on for the future. But they have to earn their stripe to just change the guard.
Thanks.
Nathan?
Well, thank you very much, Zina. Good day, gentlemen. Dukes, what are you most looking forward to against Australia? What are you guys expecting from Australia this coming weekend?
Yeah, I've obviously done a lot of analysis these past couple of weeks, and I have watched quite a bit of the Super Rugby. I know we're not participating in that anymore, but the way the Australian sides have started to play, it's been a bit more dynamic and a bit more free flowing. So yeah, I think they played very well against Wales. They managed the game quite nicely, and we've come up with great plans to try and counter what they're getting right with a new coach. So yeah, I'm looking forward to the challenge this weekend. I know all the boys are up for it, and yeah, we haven't had great success here in Brisbane, and a lot of us here are looking forward to trying to rectify that this weekend.
Ashfaq?
Thanks, Ina. Hi, Rassie. Hi, Dukes. Russ, just in terms of Sasha at 10, we've seen him now come on at fullback and we've seen him run the show for the junior Springboks as a flyoff, but he hasn't played much for the Stormers at flyoff. What do you want to see from him in terms of not only game management, but om zijn vaardigheden te gebruiken? He's got a wonderful skill set, passing, chipping, all those things.
Yeah, hello, Ashfaq. The big thing is, Obviously, because he's 10 and he's starting at 10, and 10 is pivotal in every test match and in every game. You know, but it's somebody that we know well. He's not somebody that has just fallen into our system. It's somebody that came through our system. And, you know, like Damien Willemse, when he came through the system. And as I say, there's so many guys that can compete for that number 10. Like in 2019, we only had 1-9 really, and Herschel burst onto the scene. We just didn't have a 2020 to nurture some guys in, of course, of COVID. But now we do have a 2024, where we're currently. And we do have the opportunity to get guys from one level of a test match, a tier two nation, playing off the bench. What do we expect from him? You know, to with guidelines within how we want to play on defense and attack. And then he must bring Sasha to the table like Andre brings Andre to the table. We all know what Marnie does when Marnie is on fire. And we're expecting the same from Sasha, and we hope to create that environment where he can be himself and bring the natural talent like all the other guys.
Sorry, just quickly, Dukes, just on Sasha, what have you made of Sasha so far, Dukes?
Yeah, I really enjoy him. he's very well-spoken, and he's got a lot of confidence, which I really enjoy. I obviously know on Saturday it's his first start, and I obviously know he will be quite nervous, but I hope that he will be nice and composed, because when he is composed and he's expressed himself, he's exceptional. So, yeah, I'm looking forward to this match, but I know that I'll try and keep him composed and let him express himself on the field and lead our forwards going forward. And yeah, like I said, if he can just express himself and play his natural game, I think he'll be an amazing joy to watch.
Kaniso?
Thank you very much, Zina. Rassie, just talk us through, as a coach, how do you feel when you've got so many options at fly-off? I mean, you would have played in an era where fly-off options were thin, where you would have started coaching around 2005, fly-off options were thin then. But you've been in a place where you've been able to build fly-off depth to a point where you can pick any sort of fly-off and it has no impact on how the team plays.
Yeah, Kanisha, we're trying to do that in every position. As I said to you, Erge has got a bit of a niggle, and Ruan next guy must step up if Erge is not 100% ready for Saturday. I think if you look in every position, we're trying to do that. I mean, is it Ox? Is it Kitsi? Is it Gerard, you know? Is it Tooks? Is it Bongi? Is it Malcolm? Is it Grobbies? Is it Andre Hugo? You know, is it any of the hookers? Is it Joseph? We've given at every level. We're trying to have our succession planning in place. I can talk the same on tight eights. I can talk the same on four locks. I mean, we don't even talk about Luert, who's out, John Klein, who's out, Franco Mostert, who's out, you know, Jasper Wiese, who's not here. So, you know, Alrich starting, Ivan is out, and we've got Alrich, who's playing his fifth cap. So, Wals not trying to lose momentum, and Wals keeping, obviously, the supporters' interest and trying to win. That's definitely something. So yes, at fly-off we do now have a lot of options, but it's because we the selecting committee and the coaches have made some brave choices and sometimes lose matches to try and see how guys can go from one level to another level. That's why we had the SAA games. You know, that's also games where Sasha and other guys played, and you get to learn the characters, to understand the characters, and I think that's most important. It's the succession planning while trying to win.
Francois?
Thanks, Z. Rossi, just maybe the last one on Sasha. Just what have you seen from him, or what do you like from him in training in terms of the pictures he's painting along with Tony's evolving of your tech at the box?
I think he was with us at the SAA side 2 years ago, was it, when we played against Munster and Bristol, and he was with our Springbok team, and he impressed then, and he impressed at the Junior World Cup, just like a lot of other guys, Jaden Hendricks, and a lot of other guys that I can mention here. So obviously the nice thing is when you track those guys from a certain age, you know what their capabilities are. I mean, a guy like Salman Murat is another four, and you can see that I don't just want to pin something on one specific guy. I'm trying to tell you that, you know, Salman Murat is a guy that was captain against Portugal. And he will definitely play again and start again and captain South Africa somewhere again. And Sasha is the same. So the one thing that we do see with these guys, the younger guys come through with skill sets, which gets coached at school with the EPD system, which we don't have to tinker a lot with or change a lot with. They're really well around it. But as Dukes rightly said, it's somewhere you're going to get a snot club in a test match. And okay, yeah, I'm here at the big level now. It just depends when and then who's around him and who will support him and how he handles that. And sometimes he's going to fly. And that's always the exciting thing to look forward to because he's definitely got all the natural talent.
Percy?
Zina, I'm willing to wait until the end of the comments, please, man.
Okay, well, good. Ronaldo?
Hey, Coach Rossi, Damien. I hope you guys are well. Coach Rossi, I just want to check with you. It's great to see there's a lot of young talent coming through and getting some game time this weekend, especially on tour with guys having some valuable exposure and experience, and also inspires the younger generation that's coming through, especially in the Currie Cup levels, as you can see the talent that's brewing there. What kind of impact do you expect from the younger guys coming through on this weekend's game?
Yeah, we're definitely trying to make the squad understand and be as honest as we can, you know, that this is a group effort going to 2027. And what Damien has to do to help, and Lucanio has to do, and Jesse has to do, and when Kanan's fit again, and, you know, the Ethan and Hooker and all of those kind of guys which we had in camp, it's if we work as a group together, we'll probably prolong some guys' careers and see how deep they can go until the next World Cup and where, you know, they will fall off the pace and maybe spare their bodies a lot. And that's what we're expecting from the young guys, to bring that energy and maybe swap in and out. And then against a major country like Australia, select 4 or 5. And then maybe next week go a little bit bolder. But again, it's all about momentum. It's also about how our supporters are feeling and how you guys, the media, are feeling. And if, you know, it's sometimes a bad loss stops momentum and growth and so on. So hopefully we can keep momentum and these guys can produce and show what they have.
Lita?
Thank you, Z. Hi, Rasi. Hi, Damien. Damien, hello. Maybe just for you, do you miss your 2019 World Cup centre mate, or and then just how is things going with your combination with your 2023 one?
Yeah, personally for me, I don't mind who I play with. I think Lucanio and Jesse. I don't know who's 1 and 2 in the world at 13, but yeah, I think they could both be number one in the world. I think they're the best 13s in the world. And I'm very privileged to play rugby with them. I'm glad they are on my outside, whether it's Jesse or whether it's Lucanio. But yeah, like for Lucanio, it's been a rough couple seasons. I know he's had a lot of niggles, a lot of weird injuries, obviously before the World Cup last year, and then obviously in the URC this year. So I think for Lucanio, it's just been a bit unfortunate, but it was lovely to watch him play against Portugal. I know we lost Andre quite early, but the way Lucanio commanded that backline in the way, I think he covered 12 and 13 that game, was very impressive. And for him to do that, his first test back in a very long time, it speaks volumes of him. So, but for me personally, I don't have a preference. I'm just not very lucky to have either one of them on my outside.
Liam? Liam, we can't hear you. Let's go to Dylan. Liam, if you can just type in the chat, that would be great.
Thanks, Zina. Hi, Rossi. Hi, Damien. Hope you're both well. Rossi, just take us through that bench, because it's quite an interesting couple of selections that you've made there. Firstly, it must be good to have Malcolm Marks back, fit after what happened in the second test against Ireland, but Also going for DJ, Marco and Quacko on the bench, you've gone for three players that regularly play at loose forward and have a very high work rate. Is that something that you see as very crucial in this match?
I definitely think the way we go here is either the two locks must go 80 or Peter Steph must move to lock. Or Ben Jason, we've been trying him a lot at not to play him out of position, but can do almost like a Peter Steph did in the past. I remember a lot of people said Peter Steph should just play lock, and then which we all thought was his position in the beginning, and then he became one of the best sevens in the world. So we think Ben Jason can learn a lot of from Peter Steph, and the way Peter Steph can alternate between seven and five. And then this bench is picked here to, for an Australian team who likes to keep the ball in hand, will definitely try and move us around, and we'll have to make sure there's not too many gaps. And normally the forwards are the guys who suffers when the pace is really high. So either moving Peter Steph to five or getting three fresh loose forwards on, or maybe moving Ben Jason to one of the locks. But again, as I said, Arge's got a little bit of a niggle, and we might even move Ruan State to the starting lineup to have a specialist five. So yeah, it's just a normal 6-2. I think you guys are now used to us playing 6-2. With a guy like Quacha, if we get three injuries in the back line, a guy like Quacha obviously covering somewhere in the back line.
Steven?
Thanks. Yeah, I'm happy to wait for the Afrikaans if that will facilitate more English questions.
All good. Liam? Liam, no, we can't. We actually can't hear you. Please type in the chat, Liam. We'll go back to Kaniso.
Thank you very much. Rasi, again, just talk us through playing at 2:45. I'm in Brisbane. I mean, the Boks have generally played a lot of rugby in the evening in Australia. How does it change preparation and stuff? I know that Adelaide last year in 2022 was an afternoon game. This one too. So how does that change preparations a bit?
Yeah, I just think it's on the day that the players must sink themselves to fire at that time of the day. And I think when we used to play Currie Cup rugby and Super Rugby was always late afternoon five. But I mean, we've been now here and I think we passed the jet lag phase. Some guys are still a little bit droopy and so on in the mornings. But I don't think the time of the game should affect us. We'll have our captains run. We normally have our captains run anyway, not in the time of when the game is played. You know, we try to get it out of the way as quickly as possible on a Friday so the guys can start getting themselves prepared to fire on time for the game. Obviously, we didn't do that 2 years ago when we were here or when we were last year. Well, we're not the last four times we visited Brisbane, but we weren't all part of that. But yes, it's just, I think the competition, Sanzar, you know, is also trying to, not trying, definitely, we would like to promote the game here. And it's like the start of the kickoff for the Rugby Championship, you know, it's Australia, who's got the next World Cup, who's doing really well at the Olympics, who's playing the World Champions, 3 o'clock afternoon, first game of the Rugby Championship. So, you know, we buy into all of that and try to market our game as best as we can. And the guys will be ready. 3 o'clock is not an unusual time for us in South Africa.
Justin?
Thanks, Zeke. Hi, Coach. Hi, Damien. Rassie, just for you, in terms of the law variations that have been introduced, do you guys, you know, kind of find it going to be okay in order to adapt according to what is expected of you guys when it comes to match day on Saturday?
Yeah, I think the most interesting one, which we I think will be very, not foreign, but difficult to, not difficult, the same for everybody, but it's the box kick. When the guys say use it within 5 seconds, when the ball is available, I think that will definitely change a lot of things. If the referee is going to call, use it when it's available, and they're really going to stick on that 3, 4, 5 seconds. I think that's probably something that they really worked hard at. The other stuff is, you know, kicking within 60 seconds, forming a line, forming a scrum quick enough. you know, the crocodile roll that's out, all of those things, not a lot there that we have to adjust to. So it will be interesting in general play if there is teams exiting or from box kicks, how the Nines handle the pressure and how the referees handle that. Apart from that, I think we're all good.
Right.
Yeah, sorry, my question was also on the law variations, and you sort of covered it there. But just like no contesting, the scrum half can't come past the centre sort of the scrum. Do you think some of these changes will have unintended consequences for the game if you play it through in weeks to come? I mean, they sound good on paper, but I do wonder if it's changing some of the fabric of the game. That little contest at scrum is always a good one between scrum halves and so on.
Yeah, I think the first one is, you know, it's interesting that a not straight throw in if the opposition doesn't go up, is that going to put less pressure on the hooker? And obviously then if the ball is not thrown in straight and nobody went up, you know, you won't get a scrum. So you might have less scrums there for not straight if everybody doesn't go up. And then if you make the guys go up in the line out, then probably there'll be more space to attack. So I think what we just have to do is be the first team that adapt the best. I think, we've been working really hard with Jakob Paper, and we've know the law changes and we're on top of it. And it's the same for everybody. And, you know, if you knock on a ball, there's still a scrum, you know. So if teams want to attack, we're going to scrum. If we knock on a ball, there's still going to be a scrum. So I can see where they're heading with it, and we support it because we've got a say on those forums. And we must now keep your mouth shut, accept it, and see if we can adapt the quickest.
Sorry, just quickly, how long did you have to prepare? Because obviously they only sent out the press release to fans and media today. But I'm presuming you've had a lot more time. Just what time frame have you had to work on it?
I don't know if I'm allowed to say exactly what happened in what high performance meeting and who represents us where, but you know, we get the information. It's not in isolation that World Rugby makes these decisions. You know, we've got somebody representing us there at high performance flock and referees level, and we get input. And so it's not a one-sided decision by World Rugby. We all as coaches and high performance manager and referees managers get opportunity to give input. And then, you know, it's basically come down to a vote and getting a decision. And then it gets, we've at least had 2 weeks.
Ashfaq?
Thanks, Zina. Damien, just on the Wallabies and their backline particularly, they seem to raise a game for you guys, particularly in Australia, and their centres quite effective, Len Ikita, Antepe Sami. How do you see that battle on Saturday, and is there something you can change? And then Rassie, just quickly on Eric Lowe's selection at number 8 as well, please. What do you want to see from him? Thanks.
You want me to go first?
Yes,
please.
Yeah, obviously we haven't done too well against them in the past, especially in Australia. Obviously that last test in Adelaide, I think they shocked us quite a bit. Not just the centres, but the whole team. So, like I said, I've watched a bit of Super Rugby when I was in Japan, and it's been nice to watch. So I got a good idea of how they want to play and the style they want to play. And I have bet against them before, so I kind of know what to expect. They're all fantastic players, and I'm looking forward to the challenge. But yeah, I think we're a lot more well prepared than what we were in 2022.
Just on Ulrich, again, I'm going to bring it back to the squad principle. It's nice to get a guy to play his fifth cap and not play his first cap, and now be settled and has been in and out of the team. He had some, you know, he can play 7, he can play 8. He's certainly a physical player, certainly a fast player, certainly an aggressive player. And, you know, bad luck on Ivan not getting selected and now having operation. But, you know, Jasper is back. Dwayne retired last year. Ulrich was always on the radar. Ivan had a good chance and must get that up to clear things up. Quagga, you know what Quagga can do off the bench for us. We gave him a few starts now. And again, it's trying to get caps under guys, belts, who's good enough to represent the country and not become a 1-2 test cap player and hopefully play like all the, lots of the other guys in the group, 50 test caps and compete World Cup. So it's a nice... It's not his first start. He can't be too nervous. He's quite settled. He's playing with a lot of guys that plays with him. So yeah, hopefully he's nice and calm and bring the physical side of things like Jasper and all the other guys to.
Last English question, Nathan.
Thank you very much, Gina. Russ, let's just talk about your captain. Siya Kolisi is rumored to be coming back to South Africa. A while back, Russ, you said it would be ideal to have a national captain to be based in the country. What are your thoughts on him potentially coming back to South Africa?
No, we actually didn't want him back, but his agent kept on nagging, and yeah, I'm joking. Siya, you know, when we heard he wants to come back, obviously it's out and out a Sharks decision, and then we obviously back it up with, you know, if we want to support something like that. So obviously when they ask us, we're supporting 100%, and it's lovely to have him. They will obviously officially announce it. They asked us to join up in the conversation if we want him back, and our answer was yes. Obviously, it's nice to have your captain in your country, but I'm not quite sure how far the deal is or if the Sharks signed him and when it's announced. So, but yes, we know about it and we're happy about it.
And then to Afrikaans, Percy.
Zina, ek sê vir baie dankie. Goeie dag sê jy, menere. Meneer Rasmus, ek vra jou 'n opsomming oor die samenstelling van hierdie groep, span wat jy gekies het van 23 spelers. En dan die tweede deel van my vraag is, Rasmus, kan ek jou vra, dis nou die derde seisoen as ek het reg het, want wat ons Suid-Afrikaanse franchises nou in Europa speel, maak dit nog enigszins 'n saak vir julle as 'n nasionale span, dat julle nie meer so gereeld teen, sê byvoorbeeld in hierdie geval, Australiese spelers in Super Rugby speel. Ek hoor Damien praat van, julle het gekyk hoe hulle speel op televisie, maar dis 'n ander saak as julle Saterdag op die veld gaan hardloop. Gaan Rassie Rasmus sy span net om 5 punte te gaan kollekteer teen Joe Smith en sy span?
Ja, okay, so daar is 3 vrae, hallo Percy. Die eerste ene is die samenstelling van die span. Ek dink die span verseker hierso intern weet dat hierdie is 'n groepboging. Ons kyk nie te ver vorentoe nie, maar ook nie net hier na die hede nie. Maar ons moet ook 2027 in ons gedagtes hê. So, ou praat altyd van ons groei maar saam en ons bou maar saam en ons help mekaar. Weet, ouer ouens help jonger manne en jonger manne help ouer manne sonder om die competitiveness weg te vat. Die competitiveness, die competitie, competerendheid moet daar so bly in die groep en dis wat ons verwag van hierdie groep, maar ons verwag ook van die groep om van mekaar te leer en dan om jong ouer manne, jonger ouens kalm te hou en jonger manne, ouer manne bietjie te druk en dat ons die groep kan redelik baie aanpas van toets na toets, so dit op die groep en ek, soos ek gesê het net in Engels, ek dink daar is omtrent so 9 manne wat nie regulars was nie en nou praat ek nie eers van ouens wat beseer is soos Gaza en John Klein en Loot en ag, Ivan en 'n klomp ouens, Jasper wat nog geskors is en Kitsie wat nog terugkom. So daar's 'n hele paar ouens wat nie eers hierso is nie. Praat nie eens van die Jordan en die ouens wat ons al getry het in die ander toetse op 10 en so aan nie. So dis van die groep se kant. Die groep effort wees is nie net 'n 23 effort, dis eintlik meer 'n 45 man effort. Die tweede vraag is, wil speel ons Super Rugby in die meenie? Wel, ou kan nou maar net seker die ander kant van die munte kyk en sê ons speel nie einde van die jaar toere, speel ons nou, is nie vir ons so vreemd nie, want ons speel teen Ierland en Wales en Skotland en jy weet Engeland is 'n bietjie foreign to us, want ons speel nie in hulle in 'n amptelike kompetisie nie, maar ons doen tog in die European Cup. Soos hulle erns trek, so ek dink maar net einde van die jaar toer in Super Rugby het omgeswaai waar die Super Rugby vir jou die Tri Nations Rugby Championships familier gemaak het die spelers, maak dit nou nie, maar weer eens 'n klomp van hulle sal nie teen ons ouens speel wat in Japan speel en wat in Frankryk speel en wat in ander lande speel, so dis dieselfde en dan wil ons 5 punte hê, al ons wil net wen hê, ons wil momentum hou, hierdie jong ouens 'n goeie platform gee om hulle carrières van 5 toetse af op te vat en dan hopelik kom ons weg met 'n wen. Bonuspunt sal great wees, maar ons kyk op hierdie stadium net na wen.
Last 3 questions guys, Steven.
Baie dankie Zee, hey Rassie. Rassie, ek weet jy mag nou nie klaar oor die reels nie, maar die ene wat vir my baie interessant is en ek weet nie hoe dit gaan manifesteer nie, is hierdie lyn staan ene. Want jy weet, ek kan nou effektiewelik die bal van skeef ingooi. En dan jy moet contest om jy weet effektieflik as die verdedigende span. So en my eerste vraag is wat behels contest, want kan jy amper half 'n klugspel skep waar jy net in 'n area spring waar die bal nie gegooi word nie. En dan tweedens, jy kan ook vir my 'n tegniese les hierso gee ook, is as jy contest en daar's 'n bal wat 5 meter van jou doellyn af ingegooi word, hoe raak dit jou verdediging dan van die mal af?
Ja, ek dink ons het dieselfde vraag gehad. Dit is baie goeie vraag en ons het dieselfde gevra en ons het goeie antwoorde teruggekry, Steven. Dit gaan definitief die game bietjie beïnvloed. 'n Haker wat onder pressure is 5-3 van jou doellyn af, ja, hy kan die bal so bietjie, hy moet hom in die lyn staan vir iemand gooi. Dis die eerste ding. Jy kan hom nie reguit vir die 9 gooi nie of jy kan hom nie oor vir die 15 vir die fly af gooi en hom heeltemal skeef gooi en verwag nou gaan daar niemand op in die lyn staan nie. So die eerste ding is jy moet hom vir iemand in die lyn staan gooi. So dit het ons klaar uit te kom. Klaarheid oor gekry, ons verstaan dit. En dan die ander ene is, jy kan nie, wat sy ander gevra het oor skeef ingooi, wat is jy, of hulle opgaan of nie.
So, oor die verdediging, maar ook, ja.
Ja, oor die ander ene wat jy natuurlijk nie kan doen nie, ja, jy kan nie net reguit skeef ingooi nie. So ons, en wat is contesting het jy gesê, wat is amplik, wat is spring? So het, ons het hulle gevra, en dis waar jy amplik iemand optel in die lijn staan. So ons kan nie laat ox, of wie ook al voor gaan staan Gerard en hy spring net in die lijn staan en sê ek het nou contest nie. So dit tel nie as 'n contest nie. Dit is fisies iemand wat opgelig word in die lijn staan en vir die bal gaan. So ja, ek dink het gaan aanpassing vat vir die skeidsregters en ek dink het gaan hier en daar druk van die hakkers af vat en natuurlik gaan dit so 'n bietjie jou planne verander 5 meter uit van jou eie doellyn af. Anders kan die ou mee op die buiteskouer gooi en hulle kan lekker momentum kry en ons gaan so 'n bietjie minder skrams kry, maar dis is ons het verstaan. Ek hoop dit antwoord jou vraag.
And then we'll do Leighton and Francois, and then guys, we have to wrap up, eh?
Rassi, net in terme van hoe jy tans dinge doen, in 2018 het jy ingekom waar jy moes dinge aan mekaar slaan onder groot druk. Ons weet van 2020 COVID ook, wat dinge so bietjie bemoeilik het, maar voel jy dinge so bietjie makkeliker nou? Maar verkies jy dat daar dalk so 'n bietjie meer druk moet wees om spelers te integreer sodat die span vinniger kan saam gel as jy my vraag verstaan?
Nee, ek dink die belangrikste is bro, ek en die man kom nou op pad behalwe van die Stormers af, maar bro, van 2018 af kom 'n ou deur toetse en deur COVID, ek vat net vir hom en hy langs my en deur siektes en families wat al siek was en leeuwstoere wat sonder fans gespeel was en World Cup wat jy moet verdedig en so nee, die druk raak nie minder, ons bly maar in ons reality hierso en ons weet wat ons doen en ons word nie weggevoer met weet geskiedenis oor wanneer laas ons gewen het en weet wat 'n ander coach se opinie is of wat ander mense opinie is. Ons try maar tamelik eerlik met mekaar wees die hele tyd so binne en nee, dan maak dit nie die druk minder. Ons weet wat van ons verwag word Saterdag en ons weet so gou is wat ons maak miskien nou 'n klomp changes en try 'n klomp ouens en ons weet as jy verloor aan jou kant is Saterdag aand en dan swaai die pressure weer om en dan sê almal weer ou's bietjie nee, ek doen op 'n lelike manier nie. So ons play die realiteit of van waar ons hierso is en solank ons dit doen dan sal hy te uitdruk op ons dieselfde bly of dit baie goed gaan of average of sleg.
Francois?
Ja, dankie sie. Rassi, net so oor Joe Smith se comments nou die dag, net jou opinie daarop is, of hy so bietjie, of die mense dit so bietjie verwar het, hoe hy nou pronoem van, hoe geluk soms met verwysing na die Springbokke natuurlik, soms 'n rol speel, in van die wenne, net jou siening daarvan, en net sy span, en die veranderinge wat hy ingebring het as coach met 'n klomp nuwe spelers, ses rookies wat hy gekies het ook, en hoe moeilik dit soms maak om hulle dalk te analyse as ja. Australiese span met so baie nuwe spelers in.
Ja. Ja, ek dink ons is 13 uit ons laaste 17 games, dink ek, en ek dink hulle is obviously nou 4-4. En ek ken vir Joe baie goed, hy is 'n regte old school coach, jy weet, hy dissipline, hy coach ouens regtig goed, maar ek dink dink ons almal weet hoekom hy het gesê het. Ek dink op hy gedink gaan 'n bietjie pressure op Loupeers kom en dan vind ek dit rub of the green en wat is 'n bietjie gelukkig dan dat Kos jou kant toe gaan. Ons almal weet dis die waarheid. Dis die geval met Suid-Afrika nie. So ek dink dit is nog regtig werk met Loupeers nie. Weet hy's 'n ervare referee en hy sal nie val vir so iets en ons almal weet dit is definitief die waarheid dat ons die rub of the green kry nie. So ek dink om watter ander rede het sou gesê het hy so. Maar soos ek sê, Joe is old school, jy weet, hy sit pressure op sy spelers, ons spelers, en referee, hy's 'n regtig goeie harde coach wat weet wat hy wil hê. En ja, ek het nie 'n tweede vraag onthou nie. Wat was dit?
Net oor die veranderinge wat Joe ingebring het in sy tyd en hoe die Wallabies so half heel anders span, soos 'n ander span wil ek ken.
Ja, nee, hulle is definitief 'n ander span en Joe het die vermoë, soos ek vir jou sê, ek ken hom regtig goed. Ek dink hy het ook gesê hy ken Suid-Afrikaanse spelers baie goed. Ek dink hy ken nie. Hy het al baie teen hulle gecoach, maar ek dink hy het al Suid-Afrikaanse spelers gecoach. Maar hy bring 'n hoë ethiek wat ek weet second none is. Hy en Eddie is seker op te wat ure en ure in besit. En dan by kry uit ouens wat uit 160 uur se spelers het hy nommer 1 en 2 in die wêreld geword. So hy weet wat om met min talente doen en hoe om met die beste uit hulle te kry. Ek het dit eerstehands gesien daar in Ierland. So baie respek vir hom. En as daar een man is wat hierdie Australiese rugby vinnig omdraai, is hy besig om dit te doen.
Steven, sorry I interrupted you with your other question. Duke says to leave pretty soon for a massage and our time is up. So can you just do one question to Rassie just to finish it up please?
Yeah, thanks. It's actually that gaan eintlik met Dukes. Want ek onthou Rassie in 2012 het jy so van as direkteur van rugby het jy vir Dukes, jy weet daar by die WP Stormers deurgebring en ek wil net vir jou vra in terme van die tipe speler mens wat hy nou was en ook nou dat hy al jy weet 'n leierskapsrol vir jy weet langs Sasha moet speel. Ek wil net oor sy ontwikkeling, jy weet, en dat jy nou na meerigste dekade kan jy hom nou eintlik in so 'n rol gebruik waar hy 'n leier is, jy weet.
Ja, daar's 'n paar ouens, hele klop ouens, daar's 'n paar managementlede ook hier, so ek kyk vandag toe Zwandile, daarso met die ouens besig is en hoe hy dinge doen en waar hy dinge doen en waar ons vanaand kom en waar ons dinge begin het. En ja, net doek verseker, ek dink min mense weet dit. Hy was 'n paar keer as 'n onderkaptein gewees. Ek het as jy op die foto's kyk, sal jy dit agterkom. Maar ons in Nancy gewoonlik vice captains en sulke goeters nie, maar daar was hulle hele paar game. Hy's van Milnerton se beste. Dit was trots op hom en ja, solank sy body hou en ek sê hy's een van die min fisiese ouens wat ek al gesien het wat daar vir Sunny Bill en die ouens gematch het en dan kry hy weer die volgende dag pak slaap by 'n klein ouetjie. Ek baie trots op hom en ek hoop hy hou nog in die liggaam hou en ons kan nog want die ander manne leer definitief baie by hom en is lekker dat hy 'n leierskaprol vat.
Right, thank you guys. Thank you very much. I'll be sending out the recording shortly. Have a good day.
Okay.
Cheers, Khaled.
Okay, grab Rossi's mic.